This is the American Film Institute Life Achievement Award, the highest honor for a career in film. It has been presented 9 times. First in 1973 to the director John Ford, to James Cagney, Orson Welles, William Wyler, Betty Davis, Henry Fonda, Alfred Hitchcock, James Stewart, and Fred Astaire.
I had a marvelous time a year ago when the American Film Institute honored me with this Life Achievement Award. Tonight, we have 3 generations of the motion picture industry gathered here to honor one of the greatest directors in the history of movie making, Frank Capra.
The American Film Institute invites you to join us and our host, James Stewart, in a celebration of the career of Frank Capra. From Los Angeles, California, the American Film Institute salute to Frank Capra.
It's rather difficult for me to say anything at this time, naturally. However, I do want to take this opportunity of expressing my thanks and sincere gratitude to Mr. Frank Capra, the director of It Happened One Night, and Miss Claudette Colbert, who was gracious enough to co-star with me in that same picture. Thank you.
Speaking for the Academy of Science and Art, and after careful deliberation, the committee have voted that the best direction for a motion picture during the year of 1936 is awarded to you, Frank Capra, for your direction of the picture Mr. Deeds Comes to Town.
Retake, boys, it goes to town. This can't be that.
For the best directed picture of the year, you can't take it with you. In behalf of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, we present to you, Frank Capra, this award. As you know, this is the 3rd time you have won this highest of our awards. And in all sincerity, from my heart, I thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Niblo. I'm very happy to have this again.
Ladies and gentlemen, the recipient of the 10th Annual Life Achievement Award, Mr. Frank Capra. Film Institute salute to Frank Capra. Ladies and gentlemen, the chairman of the American Film Institute, Charlton Heston.
Tonight, we celebrate. We celebrate Frank Capra. This evening marks the 10th anniversary of our Life Achievement Award. As you've heard me say here before, each year our trustees bestow this honor on an artist who, in the words of our charter, has in a fundamental way advanced the filmmaking art in America, and whose work has stood the test of time. Frank Capra certainly fills that bill. His movies are as popular today as they were when they were made. Their ability to inspire us, to make us laugh, is timeless. His own life has been filled with success and adventure and a happy ending that could only happen in a Frank Capra movie. We'll hear about that wonderful life tonight. And what better guide could we have than a previous recipient of our Life Achievement Award, a star of 3 Capra classics. Mr. Smith goes to Washington. You can't take it with you, and it's a wonderful life. Ladies and gentlemen, one of America's most beloved actors, Mr. Jimmy Stewart.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure this is going to be a wonderful evening because we're here to share the life of such a wonderful man, Frank Capra. I've known Frank for over 40 years. He really started me rolling. He gave me the best parts I've ever had. Whatever happened, I always had complete confidence in him. And after the war, I didn't do very much for a while. Hank Fonda and I built some kites, and then we flew them. And that's about as near to working as we came for a while. Then one day, Frank Capra called me, and he said he had an idea for a movie. So I went over to his house, and he started telling me this story. He said, "Now, you're in a small town and things aren't going very well, and you begin to wish you'd never been born, and you decide to commit suicide by jumping off a bridge into the water, into a river, but an angel named Clarence comes down from heaven, and Clarence hasn't won his wings yet, but he comes down to save you and jump into the river, but Clarence can't swim, so you save him." And then Frank stopped, and he said, "This story doesn't tell very well, does it?" I just said, "Frank, if you want to do a movie about me committing suicide with an angel with no wings named Clarence, I'm your boy." The picture was called It's a Wonderful Life. I don't know, they're still showing it around in theaters. It's 35 years later. Amazing. I wish I could tell you his secret, but the one thing I know is he has this tremendous love for people. Or people he worked with, people in the story, people in the audience. I think Frank's a classic example of the motion picture director. But you know, I can't help feeling that for all the great pictures he's made, the best Frank Capra story is the story of his own life. It's got more highs and lows than a roller coaster. It's heartwarming. It's kind of hard to believe, really. And it could only happen in America.
Francesco Capra was born in Bisaquino, Sicily.
He was 6 years old in 1903 when his family crossed the ocean with little more than a dream to call their own. They arrived at Ellis Island, the gateway to America. Immigrants thought the streets of America would be paved with gold, but at the end of the train ride to Los Angeles, the Capras found that Sunset Boulevard wasn't paved at all. Sarah and Salvatore Capra could not read or write. A shepherd in the old country, Salvatore picked fruit in California. He wanted something better for his son, so he took Frank to school. Life in Little Sicily was hard. The whole family had to work. I hated the ghetto, Frank said later. Hated being poor. I was looking for a way out. Education became his obsession. At Caltech, he worked 20 hours a day studying and waiting tables. And in 1918, the boy whose parents could not read or write won a degree in chemical engineering. Frank Capra was on his way. In the First World War, Frank enlisted, but in less than a year, he was just another unemployed veteran. In San Francisco, a movie company advertised for a director for a short film. I'm from Hollywood, he said. He got the job. Then he went to Hollywood. At the Max Sennett studio, he was hired as a gag man. It was the golden age of comedy, and Frank learned to make people laugh without saying a word. In 1926, a comedian named Harry Langdon gave his gag man a chance to direct. The film was The Strong Man, and with it, a great American director was born. In 1977, one of the finest actresses in screen history stood right here and received the Life Achievement Award. She worked with Frank in Pocketful of Miracles, Miss Betty Davis.
An actress, not a song. Directed by Frank Capra. What do those words really mean? An average director is a traffic cop. A good director does justice to the script. A great director gives the audience a new way of seeing the world. Frank Capra is a great director. Each frame of a Capra picture is totally his vision. There's even a word for it, Capra-esque. You need many qualities to become a great director. Most of all, you need guts. Guts to say to the front office, we'll do it my way. Guts to say to the actors, that wasn't good enough. Another great director, Willie Wyler, once said, I'm not out to win any popularity contests. It doesn't matter what happens during the filming. What counts is what's up there on the screen when the audience sees it. As we will see so abundantly tonight, Frank Capra got it up there on the screen. He fought for it. He fought with some pretty determined people. He fought with Harry Cohn. He fought with the United States Army. He fought with me during the filming of Pocket Full of Miracles. I didn't always agree with him, but I always respected him. He knew what he wanted. No one deserves this award more than Frank Capra. Frank, you're everything a director should be. My congratulations.
Perhaps you're interested in how a man undresses. You know, there's a funny thing about that. Quite a study in psychology. No two men do it alike. You know, I once knew a man who kept his hat on until he was completely undressed. Yeah, now he made a picture. Years later, his secret came out. He wore a toupee. Yeah. You know, I have a method all my own. If you'll notice, the coat came first, then the tie, then the shirt. Now, according to Hoyle, after that, the pants should be next. There's where I'm different. I go for the shoes next. First the right, and the left. After that, it's every man for himself.
But he's got high hopes. He's got high hopes. He's got high in the sky, apple pie hopes. So anytime you're feeling low, instead of letting go, just remember the ant. Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
Oops, there goes another rubber tree plant.
We weren't going out, were you?
Yes, I thought
I was. We had a date, don't you remember?
Sorry, I forgot.
Oh, yeah, well, we ought to discuss where to go, don't you think?
Well,
yeah, we can't just pop out of the building with no place to go. It's a very bad idea, that, you know. I knew two people that did that once. They went out of the building, they were uncertain, so they just walked and walked and walked, and finally they just died of hunger. Now, you wouldn't want anything like that to happen, because if that happened, well, you're so beautiful.
Welcome to Shangri-La. You see, we are sheltered by mountains on every side. A strange phenomenon for which we are very grateful.
What's got to be in it?
What?
The Capitol Dome.
On paper?
I want to make that come to life for every boy in this land. Yes, and all light it up like that, too. You see, boys forget what their country means by just reading the land of the free in history books. When they get to be men, they forget even more. Liberty's too precious a thing to be buried in books, Miss Saunders. Men should hold it up in front of them every single day of their lives and say, I'm free.
The White House, my My hallowed ground. Just think, all of the presidents since Adams have occupied that noble edifice.
Needs painting.
No, I'm not drunk, madam, but you give me an idea.
Mortimer!
Darling, don't... I'm nervous now. Don't do that.
Mortimer, not that.
Get out of here. Do you want to be poisoned? Do you want to be murdered? Do you want to be killed? Do you?
In 1927, Columbia Pictures was located in a part of Hollywood called Poverty Row. And Frank made his next 25 pictures for Harry Cohen right down there at Columbia. Frank made them his own way, and pretty soon he had his name above the title on the marquee. And the picture that put both Columbia and Capra right in the big time was a little $300,000 picture comedy that became a national event. It happened one night, was Hollywood's first great romantic comedy. And a lot of people still think it's the best.
Hey, Emily, catching a workway, catch.
I hate the hard thing.
How is you wouldn't talk so much that we let a car get away?
So suppose nobody stops for us, huh?
They'll stop, all right. It's all a matter of knowing how to hit them.
Oh, and you're an expert, I suppose.
Expert? I'm going to write a book about it called The Hitchhiker's Hail.
There's no end to your accomplishments, isn't there?
You think it's simple, huh?
No.
Well, it is simple. It's all that old thumb, see? Yeah. Now, some people do it like this. Like this. All wrong. Never get anywhere.
Oh, the poor thing.
Yeah, boy, but that old thumb never fails. You know, it's all a matter of how you do it, though. You know. Now, you take number one, for instance. That's a short, jerky movement like this. That shows independence. You don't care whether they stop or not. You got money in your pocket, see?
Clever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but number two, that's a little wider movement. Smile goes with this one like this. That means you got a brand new story about the farmer daughter.
Mm-mm. You figured that out all by yourself, huh?
Nah, that's nothing. Yeah, number three, that's a pip. Yeah, that's a pitiful one. You know, when you're broke and hungry, everything looks black. It's a long, sweeping movement like this. Got to follow through, though.
Oh, that's amazing.
Hmm? Yeah, but it's no good, though, if you haven't got a long face to go with.
Here comes the car.
Okay, now watch me. I'm going to use number one. Keep your eye on that thumb, baby, and see what happens.
I stood up my eye on the thumb.
Something must have gone wrong.
Oh.
Try number two.
When you get to 100, wake me up.
I think I'll write that book after all.
Yeah, I'll think of all the fun you had, though. Do you mind if I try?
You?
make me laugh.
Oh, you're such a smart aleck. Nobody knows anything but you. I'll stop a car, and I won't use my thumb.
What are you going to do?
The system on my own.
Flying from Barbados, I kept thinking, oh, if only Clark could be standing there with me. And then this morning, I guess I got carried away on a wave of nostalgia, and I suddenly thought, who knows? Perhaps he is here. And Frank, I think we're here, both of us, to honor you and to thank you. To thank you for making magic out of a very simple little story. A story you could actually tell in a small paragraph. I remember Clark and I kept wondering, you know, even though we were enjoying every scene, we thought, what kind of reception can this kind of picture actually get? And then, you see, what I must remind you is that this was shot in 1933, really right in the midst of the Big Depression. The theater was dying, but talking pictures were making money. People needed fantasy. They needed a dream of splendor and glamour, and Hollywood gave it to them. Frank is that rare artist, a storyteller who makes you believe every word. He created this genre, which became known as the romantic comedy. Every studio copied it. And I know what I'm talking about because I was in quite a few of them. So, Frank, none came up to it happen one night. Thank you, darling. Thank you again and again.
Happened one night, Mr. Capra really went to town. Between 1936 and 1941, he made four pictures that were his way of saying thank you to America. As Frank put it, the common man wasn't common. He's a hell of a guy. And some people call those pictures Capricorn. But today, an awful lot of people call them classics.
You mean to tell me you try to kill the John Doe movement if you can't use it to get what you want?
You bet your bottom dollar we would.
You sit there back at your big cigars and think of deliberately killing an idea that's made millions of people a little bit happier. An idea that's brought thousands of them here from all over the country by bus and by freight and jalopies and on foot so they can pass on to each other their own simple little experiences. Why, look. I'm just a mug, and I know it. But I'm beginning to understand a lot of things. Why, your type's as old as history. If you can't lay your dirty fingers on a decent idea and twist it and squeeze it and stuff it into your own pocket, you slap it down. Like dogs, if you can't eat something, you bury it. Why, this is the one worthwhile thing that's come along. People are finally finding out that the guy next door isn't a bad egg. That's simple, isn't it? And yet a thing like that's got a chance of spreading till it touches every last doggone human being in the world. And you talk about killing it. Or when this fire dies down, what's going to be left? More misery, more hunger, and more hate. And what's to prevent that from starting all over again?
Nobody knows the answer to that one, and certainly not you with those slimy, bollocks-up theories you got. The John Doe idea may be the answer, though. It may be the one thing capable of saving this cockeyed world, yet you sit back there on your fat hulks and tell me you'll kill it if you can't use it. Well, you go ahead and try. You couldn't do it in a million years with all your radio stations and all your power, because it's bigger than whether I'm a fake. It's bigger than your ambitions, and it's bigger than all the bracelets and fur coats in the world.
You bet it is, John.
And that's exactly what I'm going down there to tell those people.
Goodbye, darling. Don't let anybody hurt you again, ever. They can't anyway. You're much too real. You go back to Mandrake Falls. It's where you belong. Goodbye.
Mary. You know the poem I told you about? It's finished. Would you like to read it? It's to you.
Yes, of course.
Have to say anything, Mary. You can tell me tomorrow what you think.
I tramp the earth with hopeless beat, searching in vain for a glimpse of you. Then heaven thrust you at my very feet, a lovely angel, too lovely to woo. My dream has been answered, but my life's just as bleak. I'm handcuffed and speechless in your presence divine. For my heart longs to cry out, if it only could speak. I love you, my angel. Be mine. Be mine. Oh, darling.
I guess this is just another lost cause, Mr. Payne. All you people don't know about lost causes. Mr. Payne does. He said once they were the only causes worth fighting for. And he fought for them once, for the only reason any man ever fights for them.
Because of just one plain, simple rule. Love thy neighbor. And in this world today full of hatred, a man who knows that one rule has a great trust. You know that rule, Mr. Payne. And I loved you for it just as my father did. And you know that you fight for the lost causes harder than for any others. Yes, you even die for them. Like a man we both knew, Mr. Payne. You think I'm licked. You all think I'm licked. Well, I'm not licked. And I'm gonna stay right here and fight for this lost cause. Even if this room gets filled with lies like these. And the tailors and all their armies come marching into this place. Somebody will listen to me.
This past February 1st, a devoted couple celebrated their golden wedding anniversary. Frank's partner of 50 years is seated right next to him, Mrs. Lucille Capra. Lou. Well, the young fellow sitting at Frank's table, one of Frank's dearest friends, Bob Hope, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much. I'm very seldom a member of the audience, but I'm happy to be that way tonight, Frank. And I'm happy to be here. And I wouldn't have missed this affair for our man. Frank, you've made us laugh. You've made us cry. And I'll tell you, we're all very grateful. And there's another friend of yours that sent a telegram, and they've asked me to read it. It said, "Dear Frank, Nancy and I join with your friends and colleagues in expressing gratitude for the great enjoyment you have brought to all of us and for your distinguished contributions to the industry you helped to build. You have recognized and helped us to recognize all that is so wonderful about the American character, Ronald Reagan." And by the way, on account of the budget, it's collect.
Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Falk.
I'd like to thank Frank for the coat I wore in Pocketful of Miracles. He got me this terrific coat, and he gave me a lot of good business to go with it. What happened was, I ought to tell you, this was my first Hollywood picture. I had never been in Hollywood before. Tell you the truth, I hadn't been above 14th Street that often. But, so I went to see Mr. Capra, and I said, "Mr. Capra, this is a comedy, and I think you ought to know that I'm not funny." He says, "What do you mean?" I said, "I'm a New York actor. I'm a serious actor." So he started to chuckle. I remember we were over to Paramount. We were walking down a corridor, and he's chuckling away. He said, "Don't worry, Peter, you're gonna be all right." He said, "Look at it this way. Maybe no one else will be funny and you'll be the serious relief." At any rate, I guess we did something right because, as I said, he got me this wonderful character coat and it taught me a very valuable lesson. Get yourself a good coat. I mean, the acting is secondary, and years later, I was offered another part, and I remembered Frank Capra, and I went out, I got myself a good coat. I added a cigar, and I've been eating pretty good ever since. One, I want to thank you for giving me that break, Frank. I'm very grateful for that. I want to thank you for your films, which are more than films. They were part of the fabric of my youth, part of my growing up in this country. And I want to thank you on behalf of all the supporting players in all your pictures. Frank Capra once said, "I treat all actors, big and small, the same way. I treat them like stars." And that was true. Because Frank had a genuine affection for actors, and he treated them with dignity. So let's take a look at some of those moments of glory Mr. Capra has given to character actors. I don't know if any of these actors ever made $1 million a picture, but I know that their performances are going to live forever on film.
Your lip's bleeding, George.
Yeah. I got a bust in the jaw in answer to a prayer a little bit ago.
Oh, no, 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 George. I'm the answer to your prayer. That's why I was sent down here.
How'd you know my name?
Oh, I know all about you. I've watched you grow up from a little boy.
What are you, a mind reader or something? Well, who are you then?
Clarence Oddbody, AS2.
Oddbody? AS2, what's that, AS2?
Angel, second class.
What time did Matt Brown get in?
Oh, now let me see.
half an hour after the Dooley sisters. And the Dooley sisters...
I don't care about the Dooley sisters. What time did he get in?
That's just what I'm trying to tell you, sir. It was half an hour after the Dooley sisters...
Was it 12 o'clock?
No, it wasn't 12, because the Dooley sisters...
Was it 1 o'clock?
Yes, I guess it was 1, because you...
It couldn't have been earlier.
No, it wasn't earlier, because...
Yes, I know, because the Dooley sisters weren't in yet.
No, cosmic clock struck 4, and when it strikes 4, it's 1.
We'd like to get in touch with them. It's very important.
Who's that?
Deeds. Who do you think I'm talking about?
Oh, yes, Deeds. Fine fellow, very democratic. You would have no trouble at all. Talks to anybody.
I guess we better try somebody else.
No, we won't. The next time that jumping jack comes out, I'll straddle him while you ask him your questions.
Morning, neighbors.
Remember us? We're the fellows who were here a minute ago.
Oh, yeah. Yes, indeedy. I never forget a face.
Listen, pup. We've come all the way from New York to look up a fellow by the name of Deeds. It's important. It's very important.
You don't have to get rough, neighbor. All you gotta do is ask.
Then please pretend for just one fleeting moment that I'm asking. Where does he reside?
Who?
Smite, what do you do with yourself? I mean, when you're not carrying those double strength, what do you do with yourself?
Well, sir, I putter.
Smite. But when you're alone and you want to amuse yourself, then what?
I just putter.
Putter? Do you have to have a putter to putter?
Oh, no, sir. I putter with my hands.
Well, isn't that nice? You just go right ahead with your... It's all right. How do you do that?
Well, sir, I'll show you. That's puttering, sir.
You like this?
Like it?
This work you're doing.
Oh, no, my goodness, no. Land sakes, what am I saying? Why do you do it? Look, they're very strict in this office, Henry.
Can I tell you, isn't there something else you'd rather be doing than this?
No.
Oh, go along with you. I don't believe a word you're saying.
Go on, tell me, what would you rather be doing than this?
I make up things. Poetry? No, just things. Go on, let me see some of them.
Hey, that's kind of cute.
It's Deeds, isn't it?
Hey, Joe!
Boy, I feel so good, I could spit and pot an eye. I think I will.
What'd you say? Huh? Oh, maybe I better go home. Where's my hat? Oh, thank you, George. Which is mine?
The metal one.
Oh, thank you, George. Oh, boy. Now, look, if you point me in the right direction, would you do that, George?
Right down.
Old Bill in the lone pal, huh?
Now, you just turn this way, and then right straight down there.
Well, that way, huh? My wild Irish rose. I'm all right. Oh, sweetie.
The fellow with the frog in his throat was looking for Mr. Deeds. He's here with us tonight. He worked with Frank Capra before any of us had television sets. And today, he's one of the stars of Heart to Heart. Lionel Stander.
Frank, you spoiled me for all other directors. It's no accident that so many actors gave their best performances in your films. I loved your work, Frank, because you had a genius for telling fairy tales in a hard-boiled, realistic manner. You showed that ordinary people are capable of extraordinary deeds in a time of crisis. I think today the world needs your kind of faith and hope and optimism. Thank you, Frank. Bless you.
Frank Capra is a kind of national treasure because of the inspiration he gives to others. Some of his admirers are here tonight, including an actor director sitting over there, Jack Lemmon.
I don't know any actor that I've ever known in my lifetime that had more wonderful opportunities, that had a better career in working with the most wonderful of actors, writers, directors, everything. Everything has just been wonderful. And I thank heaven for that. If I had any regrets, it would be one. I never was in a Frank Capra film so far. I love you, I respect you, I celebrate you.
Burgess Meredith.
The only time that I ever worked for you, I didn't get paid. I was in the army and you were an officer. But I warn you, if you ever ask me again, I'll work at the same price. Thank you.
Linden.
Mr. Capra, I think I learned more about comedy watching it happen one night a few hundred times than just about anywhere else. I know I learned more about democracy watching Mr. Smith goes to Washington. And for that, God bless him.
Frank McMurray.
There'll never be another Frank Capra. Love you.
Steve Martin.
I guess of all the people here tonight, I share the most memories with Mr. Capra. For he and I have known each other for over 80 years. We worked together, played together, and made many films together. So many, I can't even remember their titles right now. There's only one thing that could have made this night more special to me, and that's if this dinner had been in my honor. So, I'd like to read a quote of Mr. Capra's. An onion can make you cry, but there has yet to be invented a vegetable that can make you laugh.
Kelly Savalas.
Frank, you never gave me a coat. But anyway, here's an award from the neighborhood. Three young punks from the east side start walking to the west side. We called it Sixth Avenue. Then they call it now the Avenue of the Americas. We took a right turn, and we snuck into the Radio City Music Hall. It didn't cost us a red nickel. So your lovely picture, it's a wonderful life. And would you believe it? These young punks paid their 80 cents after the picture and went home. Let's trip it to you, sir. Thank you.
Bette Midler.
Hello. Hi. I'm here, and we're all here. This is table 312. And we had a wonderful evening. We would like to raise our glasses to you and say long live Frank Capra and everything he stands for.
Richard Benjamin.
Mr. Capra, sir, I'm an admirer and a great fan, and some people say that the way we see the world through your pictures isn't the real world. Well, let me say, it is the world the way it should be. Thank you, sir.
Art Bookwall.
Mr. Capra, I am not here to speak tonight for the motion picture industry. I am here to speak for the public who could not afford this dinner. Mr. Capra, when I was a kid, I went to the movies and I saw all your movies, and I studied Jimmy Stewart, and I studied Gary Cooper, and I studied Clark Gable, and I studied him. And if it wasn't for your pictures, I don't think I'd be the sex symbol I am today.
Frank Capra always believed that motion pictures had the power to change the world. And in World War II, he proved it. General George C. Marshall asked him to make some films to show the public and the troops why we were fighting. Frank assembled a team of the finest writers and directors in Hollywood. And for those films, Colonel Capra won the Distinguished Service Medal and the Order of the British Empire. After his war service, Frank returned to picture making. He started an independent company called Liberty Films. And his first production was It's a Wonderful Life. This turned out to be Frank's favorite film. Making that picture sure was a wonderful thing for me. I'd been away from Hollywood for 4 years. I didn't know whether I'd lost the things I'd learned, whether the things would be completely different or not. But after a week or so of making It's a Wonderful Life with Frank, I knew it was going to be all right. Acting still meant a lot to me. I could have sworn I'd never been away. I got my confidence back again. And I have Frank Capra to thank for that. Thank you, Frank. I'm going to show you a scene from the picture now. It's when George Bailey is right on the edge. He's building a loan company that's about to go under, and that's the town's fortune with it. You see, one of Frank's secrets, he always takes you way down before he brings you back up again. He really makes you earn those happy endings.
Today about the parade, the banquet. Your mother's so excited.
Must she keep playing that?
I have to practice it for the party tonight, Daddy.
Mom said we could stay up till midnight and sing Christmas carols.
Can you sing, Daddy?
Better hurry and shave. The families will be here soon.
Families? I don't want the families over here.
Come on out in the kitchen with me while I finish dinner.
Goofy! Goofy!
Have a hectic day?
Oh, yeah. Another big red letter day for the Baileys.
Daddy, the Browns next door have a new car. You should see it.
Well, what's the matter with our car? Isn't it good enough for you?
Yes, Daddy.
Excuse me. Excuse me.
Excuse you for what?
I burped.
All right, tell me you're excused. Now go on upstairs and see if little Zuzu wants anything.
Zuzu? Well, what's the matter with Zuzu?
Oh, she's got a cold. She's in bed. Caught it coming home from school. They gave her a flower for a prize, and she didn't want to crush it, so she didn't button up her coat.
What is it, sore throat or what?
Just the cold. The doctor says it's not.
The doctor? Was the doctor here?
Yes, I called him right away. He says it's nothing to worry
about. Is she running at temperature? What is this?
Just a teensy one. 99.6. She'll be all right.
Of course, it's this old house. I don't know why we don't all have pneumonia. The drafty old barn of a place. We'll be living in a refrigerator. Why do we have to live here in the first place and stay around this measly, crummy old town?
George, what's wrong?
Wrong everything, Troy. You call this a happy family. Why do we have to have all these kids?
Dad, how do you spell Frankenstein?
I don't know. Troy, ask your mother.
Where are you going?
Going up to see Zeus.
You told me to write a play for tomorrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Donna Reed.
Thank you. I was fascinated to hear Jimmy tell how It's a Wonderful Life encouraged him to keep making movies. Well, it had an entirely different effect on me. When I finished making that film, I thought perhaps I might not make any more movies. I suppose I knew on some deep level that I would never have another experience in a film to equal it. We all worked hard. I never worked harder in my whole life. There was never a let up, never a let down. But I certainly never dreamed that people would be looking at It's a Wonderful Life every Christmas Eve for the next 35 years. Frank, I am very grateful and beholden to you for letting me be Mary Bailey. Thank you.
George Stevens, Jr., the founder of the American Film Institute, conceived the Life Achievement Tribute 10 years ago, and it's grown into a distinguished tradition. George is here tonight to present the Film Institute's Silver Star to Frank Capra. Ladies and gentlemen, George Stevens, Jr.
These damn Americans, Frank Capra said of his adopted countrymen. These damn Americans, they're so free, individuals, on their own, not taking their hats off to anyone. Those early lessons, a love of country and proud independence, characterized the life and career of Frank Capra. In the 30s and 40s, he chose to sing the songs of the working stiffs, the short-changed Joes, the forgotten poor. He made films in which good men found their voices. And the films were his films, made his way. Frank was never found taking his hat off to conventional wisdom, market research, the front office, or the latest trend. At a time of uncertainty in our country and in our industry, we have much to learn from a man who came here an immigrant and enriched a new art form with his ideas and his ideals. Accepting the Nobel Prize, William Faulkner spoke of the artist's duty. It is his privilege, he said, to help man endure by lifting up his heart, by reminding him of the courage and honor and hope and pride and compassion and pity and sacrifice which have been the glory of his past. The poet's voice need not merely be the record of man. It can be one of the props, the pillars, to help him endure and prevail. Those words describe the art of Frank Capra. We told you this evening would be a little like a Capra film, filled with hope and idealism. And before we invite Mr. Capra forward, we will see the final scene of It's a Wonderful Life. It's a scene where George Bailey comes home and discovers how many friends he has, and learns that Clarence, his angel friend, has finally been given his wings. Now, you may look upon it as just the beautiful scene it is, or on this night, you may view it as the climax of our tribute, in which we remind Mr. Capra how many friends he has before we give him his wings.
Joy,
trip. The fool flew all the way up here in a blizzard.
Harry, how about your banquet in New York?
Oh, I left right in the middle of it as soon as I got Mary's telegram. Good idea, Ernie. A toast. To my big brother, George, the richest man in town.
Christmas present from a very dear friend of mine.
Look, Daddy, teacher says every time a bell rings, an angel gets his wings.
That's right. That's right. Attaboy, Clarence.
Tell you, I am just about the happiest man in the world. I love listening to all this talk about the so-called art of Frank Capra. Art. And because you've been so kind to Juan Francisco Capra, born a peasant nearly 85 years ago in Bisaquino, Sicily, tonight I'm going to tell you the real secret of the whole thing. The art of Frank Capra is very, very simple. It's the love of people. And add two simple ideals to this love of people: the freedom of each individual and the equal importance of each individual, and you have the principle upon which I've based all my films. Well, I've made my films, and now the American Film Institute is doing a wonderful job of helping a new generation to make theirs. And may I say a word to this new generation? Don't follow trends. Start trends. Don't compromise. Believe in yourself. Because only the valiant can create. Only the daring should make films. And only the morally courageous are worthy of speaking to their fellow man for 2 hours and in the dark. And now, while I'm up here, I'd like to send a few valentines. First of all, to the most important person in my life, my wife, Lou. The night I met her, I thought, what a lovely voice. I've been listening to that voice with
pleasure and delight for 50 years. Next, our three children. Frank, will you stand? Lucille. And Tom. And now our grandchildren. Stand up, kids. Frank the third, Jonathan, Maria, Claire, Teresa, Jack, Jennifer, Jim, Tony, Monica. Now sit down, you bums. Life renewing itself. Wonderful kids. 10 of them. Now I'll admit I'm a hell of a director. I'll admit that. Let me tell you something. If it weren't for stars like Claudette Colbert, Betty Davis, Barbara Stanwyck, Jean Arthur, Jane Wyatt, Fay Wray, Donna Reed, and Gable and Cooper and Coleman and Stewart, and Tracy and Grant and Sinatra and Crosby, and without brilliant writers like Bob Briskin, Joe Swirling, and Sidney Buckman, and without artistic technicians like Joe Walker, a great cameraman. Stand up, Joe Walker. Bill Hornbeck, great film editor. Bill Hornbeck, where are you, there? There he is, Bill Hornbeck. If it weren't for them, well, I'd still be peddling papers. An occasion like this, when we all get together to pay homage to our craft, it forces me to think, how in the hell did I get up here? Well, nearly 79 years ago, I celebrated my 6th birthday in the black, dark hole of a creaking ship crammed with retching, praying, terrorized immigrants. 13 days of misery. And then the ship stopped. And my father grabbed me and carried me up the steep iron stairs to the deck. And then he shouted, "Chico, look at that." At first, all I saw was a deck full of people on their knees, crying and rejoicing. My father cried, "That's the greatest light since the Star of Bethlehem." I looked up, and there was the statue of a great lady, taller than a church steeple, holding a lamp over the land we were about to enter. And my father said, "It's the light of freedom, Chico. Remember that, freedom." So, finally, there is something I must say to some other members of my family, and I believe that they will hear me. Mama, Papa, Big Brother Ben, Josephine, Tony, Little Sister Anne, remember the day we arrived at the Southern Pacific Station here in Los Angeles and Papa and Mama kissed the ground? Look, the American Film Institute has given me its Life Achievement Award. And for that, I am thanking them and all my friends who have come here. But for America, just for living here, I kiss the ground. Thank you very much.
Before you go, I'd just like to propose one final toast to Frank Capra, the richest man in town. And on behalf of the American Film Institute, good night, everybody. Good night.